Hi everybody and welcome. My name is Luke and this is The Science Lens, where I show you how science can improve your critical thinking skills. In today's episode, we're talking about appealing to authority. Recently, I released a video on how to check that the information you see online is based on peer-reviewed journal articles, and as an example, I looked at whether vitamin C can help cure the common cold. Now, when I learned that vitamin C does little, if anything, to help with colds, I started wondering, how did that idea become so popular? Now, it turns out it can be largely attributed to a man called Linus Pauling. If you don't know who Linus Pauling is, he's kind of a superstar in the world of science, because his work as a chemist and campaigning against the use of nuclear weapons led to him being the only person to ever win two Nobel Prizes as an individual. So yeah, he's a pretty clever dude. Which is why in the early 1960s, when he started promoting megadoses of vitamin C as a cure not only for colds but cancer as well, people paid attention. After all, the guy had two Nobel Prizes, he must know something we don't, right? But when scientists did more tests, it turned out that these claims about vitamin C were massively overstated. And instead of a cure for the common cold, what we had on our hands was a textbook case of the appeal to authority fallacy. An appeal to authority is when we believe a statement based solely on who's making it. So in the vitamin C example, people believed Linus Pauling not because of the evidence that he presented, which wasn't very strong, but because they saw him as an authority when it came to everything science related. People use this fallacy all the time on social media, in the news, or just everyday conversation. And to be honest, it can be really hard to avoid because sometimes we do just need to trust experts. But what's important to avoid is putting blind trust in someone's opinion simply because of who they are. So today I'm going to suggest to you three things that you can do to make sure that your trust in experts is well placed. 1. Check their qualifications. A lot of times we put trust in someone with no qualifications at all, like a kid who believes something because their parent told them, or when we listen to a celebrity who's endorsing a product. I mean, I guess it's possible that Jamie Lee Curtis has a qualification in microbiology, but I doubt it. You might also see a person giving opinions on topics that are outside their area of expertise. So when you're checking a person's qualifications, make sure you look not just at the level that they've attained, but also the area that they specialize in. A good way to do that is to check their bio section on the website of the company or university that they work for. Or if you want to go a little bit further, you could also use Google Scholar to see how many times they've been published in a peer-reviewed journal article. To do that, just use the advanced search feature and type their name into the articles authored by section. 2. Consider potential biases. Sometimes experts can be influenced by the company that they work for or just their own personal beliefs, so it's important to read a little bit about them before accepting their opinions. But we also need to be aware of our own biases when choosing who to trust, to consider if we're only doing so because they're saying what we want to hear. 3. Look for the consensus on the topic. The idea of that one rogue expert going against the system and outsmarting everybody else can be appealing, and it makes for a good movie plot. But in reality, if one scientist is saying something different to every other scientist, more often than not, that scientist is wrong. So when listening to an expert, we should check if what they're saying agrees with the scientific consensus. A good way to find out what most experts believe is to look for what are called consensus statements, which are reviews done by science journals from time to time to give a broad overview of the science on a particular topic. An easy way to find these statements is to go to Google Scholar and type in consensus in quotation marks along with the topic that you're investigating. Now, an important thing to note is that complete scientific consensus is annoyingly rare because no matter how clear the evidence for something is, like climate change, there will always be a scientist that disagrees with the general opinion. So just keep in mind that one or a few scientists disagreeing on a topic doesn't mean a lack of consensus. Before I continue, I just wanted to make a small request that if you're finding the video useful so far, please consider clicking the like button and be sure to subscribe if you'd like to see more videos like it. Okay, continuing on. So let's practice our new critical thinking skills with an example. In 2019, a committee formed by the Pennsylvania House of Representatives invited a scientist called Gregory Wrightstone to speak about climate change issues. Wrightstone's opinion was that the climate change that we're currently experiencing is a natural process and is in fact good for the planet. He has a master's in science, so should we believe Wrightstone's opinions? Well, let's find out. Number 1, find the person's qualifications. A quick Google search of Gregory Wrightstone brought me to a site called the CO2 Coalition, where he's the executive director. His qualifications are listed as a master of science, but in geology, which doesn't qualify him as an expert in climate science. He also acknowledged to the House committee that he had never published a paper on modern-day climate change in a peer-reviewed journal. 2. Consider potential biases. While I can't say for certain if Wrightstone is biased, the fact that he works for an organization that promotes CO2 as a, quote, miracle molecule suggests that he has a vested interest in denying that it causes any problems. 3. Look for the consensus on the topic. Well, this one was a bit of a no-brainer, but as you might expect, when I went to Google Scholar, it took me all of about, 3 seconds for me to find out that the scientific consensus on climate change is undoubtedly that it's caused by human activity. Now, it's important to note that being unqualified or going against the consensus doesn't necessarily mean that a person is wrong, just the same as being qualified doesn't make a person right. But it's important to play the odds, and if I had to bet on either 100 scientists who are experts that say one thing, or some dude at the pub who says something else, I know which bet I'll be taking. Well, that's it from me for today, but if you'd like some resources to help practice the concepts that I've covered, I recommend that you check out my store on TPT. There I have a range of worksheets and templates for teaching critical thinking in the science classroom, and you can find a link to that down in the description below. Also, don't forget to hit like and subscribe if you'd like to see more videos on how science can improve your critical thinking skills. And finally, I used a bunch of resources to help with this video, so if you'd like to learn more about the topics that I covered, please make sure you check out the description below for links to all of those. For now though, that's it from me. Thanks for watching.